The announcement by the angel was the greatest that's ever been told. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. We welcome you to service tonight. Trust you'll take a hymnal and turn with us as we sing the very first song. And let's just have an enjoyable time together worshiping God.
Shall we join in singing 446, please? Hark the herald angels sing. Now let's turn back one page to 445. It came upon the midnight clear.
Yes.
In all the hurry that most of us have been swept up into the last few days, and maybe particularly today, I would like for us just to take a few moments to quiet our hearts and minds, and perhaps even our bodies before the Lord. I would invite you, if you would like, to bow your heads and simply close your eyes. I think it's a very symbolic way of recognizing God in our lives. And in these moments, would you thank the Lord and reflect on His goodness to you, particularly this very evening? For the benefits of this day, for the joy of this Christmas season, we just take a few moments to say thank you, Lord, for all good, perfect, wonderful things. And Lord, in the maddening haste of life, we purpose, as the psalmist admonishes us, to be still and know that Thou art God. And in these moments of quietness, in a candlelight atmosphere, we are mindful of Your wonderful love, Your love which has extended itself so much to us, that You came in the form of a baby, that You lived and died and were resurrected, and that You live forevermore, and that You live within our hearts in these very moments. In Your name we pray.
Traveled road so dreary, and they both were tired and weary. Was there not a shelter cheery where they could get some rest? Then the path seemed rougher, steeper, and the night grew darker, deeper. So they ask an old innkeeper if they could be his guest. But he showed them to a manger in a stable free from danger. Mary birthed a little stranger while all the world ignored. On that night the inn was crowded, and the minds of men were clouded. There in swaddling clothes enshrouded lay Jesus Christ the Lord. No room was there for them that day. Tax to pay, no room except a bed of hay, no room. tax to pay, no room except a bed of hay, no room, no room, no room. To this humble situation came the Lord of all creation, bringing down to us salvation, God's gift of love from heaven. It would do us well to ponder that his love we do not squander. Oh, what hope, what joy, what wonder God's gift to mankind give. Make room within your heart today. Make room, do not turn him away. Make room and let him hear you say, there's
Book of Matthew, chapter 2, beginning to read with verse 1. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and we are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not thou the least among the princes of Judah? For out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Thank you.
shepherds and the stunning thrills as they went to Bethlehem town to see what could be there to see. Over in Bethlehem town, as the silent stars shone down, Mary sang songs to her pretty little baby. Never on earth was such a pretty baby. Over in Bethlehem town, as the silent stars shone down, as the silent stars shone down.
A part of every service is really one of giving, and we wanted to give you that opportunity to give in an offering tonight. Ron Bauer, Ray Prawl, John Henning, and Dale Bailey are going to help us as ushers, and so if they'll come just now, we'll receive this offering as a Christmas present really to the Lord of his kindness and goodness toward us. Thank you. We appreciate the teens and the young people around the church. Kind of keeps you young, you know, to be around them. Let's sing together again, number 449 in the hymnal, the first Noel, number 449. The first Noel, and let's stand together as we sing, please. Shall we stand? Seated and just turn over one page if you would. I think the most popular of all Christmas music is Silent Night. It's number 451. You really don't need a songbook for it. Might be as well if you didn't use it. Silent Night, Holy Night.
Thank you.
almost 2,000 years ago, or some would say something like 1976 years ago, like every other baby born in Bethlehem that night, Jesus was born of a woman. Like every other baby born in Bethlehem that night, he was wrapped in swaddling clothes or the customary cloth of that day. Like every other baby born in Bethlehem that night, he came helpless, needing the watchful care, nurture, and strength from his mother. Jesus came expecting no special treatment and no special favors. Even though he came as the Son of God, he accepted the circumstances surrounding his birth that were exactly like every other child born. However, unlike every other child born in Bethlehem that night, he was cradled in a trough. Probably it was a feeding trough that was lined with fodder. Probably it had been already prepared to feed the animals. For you see, unlike any other baby born then, he was born in a stable. Other babies that were born in Bethlehem that night had attendants and those who cared for them. The attendants for Jesus were not all even human. They tell us there were oxen and sheep and donkeys who were in that same building. And so it was that Jesus made his appearance on planet Earth that night by entering into the lot of the poor and the helpless. You see, Jesus got down underneath us that night that he might lift us. He not only stooped from heaven, he dropped from that divine status past the angel status and took on humanity. And if that weren't humble enough, he plunged one step further and came as the poorest of men, born in a stable, with animals and unfavorable surroundings. Interestingly enough, and one I think of the great lessons of the Christmas story to us, is that Jesus never tried to escape one single identification with mankind. As a baby, he cooed and he cried. He struggled and wrestled with life as any other child. He suffered, he hungered, he became elated, he also became discouraged. For the Bible tells us that he lived life at its very worst, as well as its very best. Jesus, in every aspect, became one of us, except one, that he did not sin. Otherwise, Jesus entered onto the stage of life and experienced every principle of experience that you and I will ever face or have ever faced. The place where he was born, and where he was raised, rather, later, was that of Nazareth. Nazareth seemed to be selected for its obscurity and for perhaps its name of not being known so well. In fact, the scripture says that there was a question asked of Nazareth. Someone said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" He was not born in Jerusalem or raised there, where the important church leaders were of that day. He was not born into a prominent family, nor in a metropolitan area or on a seaport city. But he was born in Bethlehem, and he grew up in a little town called Nazareth. You see, Jesus deliberately took the way of least attention so that in time he would truly become known as the Savior of men. And another one of the favorite titles Jesus has of himself was that of the Son of Man. Probably if we were to look at him, we would prefer the title Son of God. But he often went by that of the Son of Man. Jesus always preferred to be identified with the commonest of men, so that someday, and even in our day, every person could be identified with him. A would-be rescuer of a drowning man cannot save that man unless he goes where the incident is happening. In other words, to save someone who's drowning, you have to get out there where he is. You have to go beneath the surface. And there are times where people have lost their lives trying to save someone else. Maybe in a very meager way, that's precisely what Jesus Christ did. He got out there in the thick of the storm, where the billows were high and the waves were breaking and where mankind was dying. The neediest of people were his special interest group. We kind of think that in the 76, 77 category, we've coined a new phrase, special interest groups. But Jesus knew about those people a long, long time ago. Nearly 2,000 years ago. Tonight, the manger and the baby represent to us God's special gift to mankind. The manger represents to us Jesus' willingness to step down to become one of us. And if you haven't really let him rescue you, may I admonish you that even this night, even now, you allow his presence to direct your life. Maybe there's no other more beautiful time than a Christmas Eve for a person to say, "Yes, Lord, I do want you in my life." The manger also represents to us that sometimes the most precious people and the most precious happenings come from very unexpected sources and places. For you see, that manger years ago held the Son of God, but who would ever look for a king in a feeding trough? But then you have to remember, you can't determine greatness by the standards of the world or by material values. For Jesus Christ is great, whether in a royal bed or a cattle shed. He still is great. The shepherds discovered that their crude surroundings would not dim the star that shone overhead. And true greatness is not the trimmings or the wrappings, but true greatness lies in giving of love and of caring for family. Christmas Eve is one of the most precious times a family may have, for the occasion of a dad and mother, or grandparents, to express love to their family. Oh, we do other things, let's care and express it. Jesus Christ came very quietly into this world. In fact, I suppose if we were to look at it very, very closely, we could almost say that he came secretly. Though that's hedging on that a little. But he did come into this world without fanfare and without trumpets and without procession. He came really without acclaim and honor and pomp and circumstance. And in that, I believe he set an example for us, for our lives, and for our world. Because you see, as we go out into the world of Christmas, as we go out to be an example to those who do not know God, there are times that we very quietly would light a light. Most often we quietly do a service for someone else. It is almost without exception that in loving and caring for that one without God, it is done in quietness. Quietly sacrificing, quietly searching for ways to radiate love. You see, that's how Jesus came. Jesus came in a manner in which he is able and was able to find people of all needs in all places and to provide an answer for that need. I love the symbolism of a manger. I don't think we need to get caught in the syndrome of staying at that point of the manger because Jesus Christ lives. He's alive tonight. His Spirit meets with us right here. But the manger does represent to us tonight the simplicity in which Jesus Christ came to us. Another good lesson of this Christmas Eve would be that the manger really tells us again that some of the greatest things and some of the greatest people that ever come to pass come out of very humble, very humble surroundings. And another lesson we can well remember tonight is that the manger can tell us that regardless of what happens in this world of our day, that nothing will dim the star that God has put there as our guiding light. To sum it all up, the angel simply said, "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." May it be a reality, and may Jesus Christ be real in your life, in your family, and in your home this night, and in this wonderful, happy, blessed season. Let us pray. Lord, we open our hearts to you tonight. We have had them open. And to all of us here, draw us closer to you than we've ever experienced before. Teach us, Lord, the lessons of really just simple faith, of believing, and then walking with you, and sharing in the love and the joy and the proclamation of the good news. In your name we pray. Amen. Turn to number 447. 447, one of the great, great songs. Joy to the world, the Lord is come.
Shall we stand together, please, as we sing 447?
Thank you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance and grant you peace, both now and evermore. Amen. Merry Christmas to all, and to all, a good night.